Now, guys, take your Bibles and turn to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter number 25. We're looking at the last part of Genesis chapter 25. We remember that as we looked at this chapter, we saw these two boys of Isaac's. Now, when we look at the life of Isaac, and we see glimpses of Isaac in the scripture whose name means laughter, we saw Isaac and his birth. Remember, when we were studying the life of Abraham, we looked at Isaac and his birth and the fact that he was born through a promise, a supernatural promise of God to Abraham. And that boy was born when Abraham was 100, his wife was 90, and it was a supernatural birth. And so we saw his birth, and we looked at Isaac not only in his birth, but Isaac and his brother. We saw the animosity between his brother, that his brother had to him, towards him, and how his brother was forced to leave, and Hagar was forced to leave because his brother, his oldest brother, Ishmael, that son of the flesh, persecuted Isaac during the time of his weaning, and he was sent away. And so we looked at Isaac and his birth and his brother, and then remember the whole chapter 24 was about Isaac and his bride. How Abraham sent out this servant to get a bride for his son. And here now we begin to look at Isaac and his boys. And we'll find out that, and we've already looked at these boys. Remember that Isaac prayed for 20 long years that Rebekah would bring forth these boys. I mean, she was barren, a sterile woman, and Isaac prayed, and the Lord entreated Isaac for his prayer. Well, that's a beautiful picture of Christ praying for his bride, Christ praying for fruitfulness in our lives, Christ praying for us. And notice now that these boys, remember, and this is Genesis 25, these boys conceived that struggle in them. And then Rebekah prayed, "If it be so, why am I thus? What's going on in me?" And she went to the Lord, and the Lord answered her, told her that you have two peoples in your womb, two nations. And they are opposing principles. And we know that this happened in real time. This is a real story, but it illustrates a great truth about every believer. And that is, we have not two nations in us, but two natures. One is a fleshly nature and one is a spiritual nature. And that there is this constant battle in us. And if you would be honest, there are times when you've wondered before the Lord, why is it this? Why can't I do without any opposition the things that I would do in my heart for the Lord? It's that Romans 6 and Romans 7 reality. Romans 7 said that when I would do good, I find this, that evil is what? Always present. There is a principle in my members, in me, that is this fleshly nature that is warring against the things of God. Though in my mind I know how those things look, but I can't seem to pull them off because of this principle of sin that dwells in me. And oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? And there is this tug of war all the time. And so that's a great illustration. But I want you to see, as these boys, and I pointed out now looking at this story, how these boys with these two completely different natures, how, of course, one represented the flesh and one represented the spirit. But as we look at this story, we see also these boys and the affections that their parents had for them. The Bible makes it clear that the boys grew, verse number 27, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man, a dwelling in tents. Now, one was a man of the field and one was a man of the fold. One was a man who was a cunning hunter, and one was a person who stayed close to home, domesticated animals, a shepherd, as it were. And so these boys were different, and they are growing. And this growth in both of them does not give way. I mean, it all speaks of this struggle, this growing struggle in us, these two boys, these two principles, these two nations, these two natures. And so they're growing, and the Bible talks about this. One was more pastoral, like a shepherd, and one has almost a, I might call, a bloodlust. You hunters in here, just go kill animals. One was a natural man. One was a person. You'll find this out as you continue to watch and read behind Esau and Jacob, that one was a person who was concerned about eternal things, and one was a person concerned about earthly things. One wanted the blessing, and the other cared little for the blessing. One despised the blessing, the other desired the blessing. Esau despised it, Jacob desired it. Now, I'm not telling you all Jacob's actions were right. In fact, we're going to look at this, but I'm telling you that he basically wanted the blessing of God. Esau cared very little about the blessing of God and eternal things. And it speaks to the type of man you might be, even as a believer. See, I've said this, and I said this in church the other night, and I said it often, but we've made our choice many times. Men make their choice for heaven over hell, but our struggle is heaven over earth. That's where that struggle comes in. We've made the choice. We want heaven over hell. But then a lot of times we choose earth over heaven. And our lives are absorbed with things on the earth. Thus we get Christ's great word to us from Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then these earthly things will be what? Added. They're not to be our pursuit. They're just to be added. Our pursuit is holiness. Our pursuit is the kingdom of God, his righteousness. These are the things, the eternal things, and then the earthly things, necessities, and even luxuries of life will be added. And so a good question today would be for me in my own life, what am I in hot pursuit of? What are you in hot pursuit of? The things of the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, positions and prestige and prominence and power, and all these things that the world esteems so highly? Or am I after the blessing of God? Which may have all of these components, but listen, these are not my pursuits. My pursuit is God's glory. And then allow him to add these things if they are to be added at all. And that's exactly right. What God desires for us are holy and pure things. And sometimes what we desire are just completely different from that. And so we have in these boys these opposing principles. This is a great lesson freighted with truth for us today. The boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. The other was... and was a plain man, and dwelling in tents. Remember how Esau looked when he was born? More like an animal, maybe, than a little boy. Red and with like a hairy garment. Looked like he had a coat on. Hairy boy, a wild man, right? And he has, and Esau, now listen, Esau, Edom, his name is Edom, which speaks of red. He was a red man. Edom like Adam, a man of the flesh. And he and so I want you to, in the very appearance, and then not just their appearance, but their appetites, different, opposing natures. And so notice, and the boys grew. See, one doesn't give way to the other; they both grow. That struggle, that initial struggle, once you became a believer in Christ. And by the way, the battle didn't start in Rebekah until fruitfulness happened. You know, the flesh doesn't mind. The flesh doesn't rise up until a person in that by the grace of God says, I want to produce fruit in my life for Christ. That's when you're going to begin to have trouble out of your flesh in that battle. Verse number 27, the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, Jacob a plain man dwelling in tents, and Isaac loved Esau. Now, this is defection of Isaac, the dad, for his son Esau. Remember, we made a point about because he did eat of his venison. But Rebekah loved Jacob. It didn't say why. She just loved him. But Esau reminded him, his daddy, maybe of himself. But whatever it was, his daddy loved this boy over the other one. And he showed preferential treatment. And we cautioned every dad in here about that with your sons and with your children. Every parent needs to learn this lesson. We can cause problems in our own house by how we treat one or the other. They all think you like the other one better anyhow. They're going to all accuse you of that anyhow. But God help us if it's so. And you may have affinities that are with one. You know, this little guy likes what you like, and this one doesn't. This one may be even a strong-willed child, and you go like this with them. And the other one is more compliant. And so it's easier to talk to this one. You have to be careful. And that's all I can say. I just tell you this. Be careful about love because. Parental love is to be love in spite of. True love descends down. Right? For God so loved the world, that goes down. He loves us in spite of. We love him because of. Because of love goes up. In spite of love goes down. God loves us in spite of ourselves primarily. He don't love you because you're such a sweet little darling. No. God loves us in spite of ourselves, in spite of the fact that we're sinful and vile. When we were yet without strength, in due time he died for us. He commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners. In spite of, the thrice holy God loves us in spite of. And we love him because he loved us. And you'll find that out about your children. When our love is a healthy love, it'll be in spite of love, a love that descends down because that's where love naturally goes, and they'll love us because. But don't worry, they'll have children that they'll love in spite of, and they'll love because. You follow what I'm saying? It all goes down. You love your children. Your children don't love you like you love them. And that's okay, right? That's just how it is. Now watch this. But they're going to love their children the way you love them. Isaac loved Jacob because he ate of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Now watch, here's the boys. Now here's this episode in the life of these boys, which is telling. Right? This is a little snapshot of these boys when maybe they were teenagers. I don't know how old they were, 15, 20, I don't know. We don't have a way to judge. If they were under 15, Abraham was still alive when this happened. If they were 16, 17, 20, then Abraham has been dead for 5 years or so. Because they were 15 when Abraham died. And Jacob sought pottage. He's cooking. And Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. I'm famished. Therefore was his name called Edom. All right. He wanted red meat, red beans, red man. A man of the moment. Now watch this. Now Jacob. You can't endorse Jacob's behavior. And here's the two. I'm going to show you two great lessons in this passage here. Notice. Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. And I want you to take and pay special attention to Jacob saying, sell me, watch this day thy birthright. And then Jacob said in verse 33, Jacob said, swear to me this day. You follow me? Now, what I'm saying is this is a right now thing. Got to do it today. Do it right now. You follow me? And watch what happens. He says, give me something to eat. And Jacob said, verse 31, sell me this day thy birthright, right now. All right, we can strike a deal. Got to be right now. Now watch Esau, a man of the moment, a fleshly man, the impulses of the flesh, the appetites of the flesh. Notice the tendencies of the flesh. And Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die. And what profit shall this birthright do to me? Now notice, that's the nature of the flesh. The flesh says, I'm going to die if you don't indulge me. I've got to be indulged right now. So Jacob takes upon this. Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore unto him and sold his birthright unto Jacob. The birthright, remember, included position and prominence and power and pastoral responsibilities for the family. Right? And it went to the firstborn. Esau's the firstborn. Jacob's not the firstborn or the one born first. But Jacob seizes an opportunity to get it from Esau. Now watch this. And Esau freely gives it up. And he does it for a bowl of stew. And the Bible has a commentary about this in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 12. And we'll look at it in just a minute. Jacob said, verse 33, swear to me this day. And he sware unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. And Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentil. Now watch this. And he did eat and drink. And remember now, eat and drink, one of those kind of phrases that you'll find throughout the Bible that usually speaks of just life and maybe sometime partying life, carefree life. Eat, drink, what? Be merry. In the days of Noah, they were what? Eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage. They were just eating and drinking. And that speaks of the appetite. So he eats and he drank and he rose up and went his way. See, there is a way that seems right to a man. There is a way that is the way of the flesh. But the end thereof are what? The ways of what? Death. And so he went his way. Remember the picture of the Holy Spirit? Remember Eliezer in chapter number 24? How when he got Rebekah, they rose up and went the Spirit's way, went his way. Well, that's where we come to a man. A man's going to go his way, he's going to go God's way. And notice, Esau, he ate, drank, indulged his flesh, and he rose up and went his way. And now listen to the commentary. Thus, in that way, Esau despised his birthright. What does it mean to despise a thing or a person? To treat it lightly. Not to value it. To be stupid with something that's valuable. It'd be like me taking my wedding band off, hanging over the edge of a ship that's moving and flicking my wedding band up. How foolish is that? I mean, I'm just flipping that thing up and snatching it out of the air. We're on a cruise ship and Phantom's belief, you know, and I'm just playing around with that. If I were to lose it or drop it, a misstep, and it goes down, I have despised this thing. I've taken it lightly. I've trifled with something that's valuable. Yeah. That's an illustration, guys. I would never do that. But now watch this. Watch this, though. Here's the great illustration of thing. How many of us are treating lightly the valuable things, the blessings, despising the goodness of God, which, by the way, is designed to lead you to what? Repentance. To lead us to a change of mind and heart about this God who loves us, this great God of love. His goodness is designed to cause us to see who he is, and instead of that, we despise it. We take it for granted. We trifle with it. We play around with it. And we let the, listen, and many times we do this, watch, to indulge momentary fleshly desires. Sacrificing the eternal on the altar of the temporal. Giving away that which is precious. Giving away that which is valuable for the vow. Is, hey, does that speak to you? It speaks to me. And look at how the writer in the book of Hebrews put it. Hebrews 12. See, we remember that those things were written before, written in the Old Testament, were written for our example. So that we can pick up the Bible and read through those stories, those illustrations, and we can be cautioned. So even as I read this, I'm being cautioned. And then the writer in the book of Hebrews in chapter number 12 says to us in verse number, let's begin at verse number 14. Follow peace with all men. Literally means pursue it. And what? Holiness. All right, with verse number 14. I'm to pursue peace with all men. I'm to pursue holiness, without which, by the way, no man will what? See the Lord. Looking diligently, all right, taking heed, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. What does it mean, any man fail of the grace of God? The idea is not falling from grace and losing your salvation. The idea of God in his goodness have blessed us with these blessings. This is the grace of God. What are you enjoying in the life of a believer? What are you enjoying in the way of grace? All the things that God has blessed us with, our homes, our health, our families, our goodness, freedom, friendships, the real things in life, the things that money can't buy, the grace of God, and we fail. We despise it. We don't live up to it. I mean, not that you earn grace, but grace ought to have there is to be a therefore response. Because of his goodness, therefore, I am to live a certain way. You follow what I'm saying? Not that I earn grace. You can't earn grace. But grace certainly ought to cause a response in me, a love because of his grace. And Paul says, you be careful now, lest any of us fail in the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. We have to be careful about the things that, watch, that grow in our lives. Things that if your life, for instance, is compared to a garden, you have to be careful that you don't let the weeds choke out that which is good. And we've got all these kind of things growing in our lives and even cultivated in our lives. And they defile us, and not just defile us, many. Because every man in here has a certain sphere of impact and influence. Am I right? And so the things that I let grow in my life, the things that spring up that I don't weed out, that I don't get diligent about, I fail in the grace of God. Do you think have to possibility and the likelihood of defiling many? Lest there be any fornicator, that's sexual sin, or profane person. What is profanity? We talk about profanity. The person uses, what is profanity? It is like the word we use for despise, taking something that is high and lofty and holy and dragging it down to commonplace. You know why we call the words we call profanity, profanity? It's because the idea of it's a violation of the King's English, which Dave might contend we don't know how to speak anyway, right? Hey, am I doing okay? All right. For a Southern boy. But it is to drag that which is high and holy down to the common. And man alive, it's an irreverence. And let me just tell you this. It says that Esau was a fornicator and a profane person. And he took the blessings of God in his life and the possibilities and the potential that was pregnant in him, and he dragged it down to commonplace. He cared nothing for them. He handled it very lightly. Big deal. No big loss. He didn't value it. And the Bible says, he, for one morsel of meat, sold his birthright. One puny little meal, gave away and sold and forfeited the great potential. Right? Beg your pardon? He's our great example in life. He's our redemption in his death. But in his life, he's our great example. That's exactly right. And do you know, speaking of what he just said, how many temptations that appeal to just the appetite? You know, the very first sin was a sin through the appetite. Eat is the middle word in death. You know what I'm saying? How many people, it's not the food so much, it's the appetite. Right? The food stands for a picture of all when Esau came in and he smelled that food, it drove all other sensible thinking out of his mind. Because his appetite, his eyes glisten. His nose is wide open, and his mouth watered, and that's just the appetite. You follow me? And he, for one morsel of meat, one little meal, gave away so very much. And so that's a caution to all of us. Now watch, I've got another point. Now the first point is this. We have to be careful about despising the blessing of God. And it's not just in the area of sex. You can take lightly an influence you can have in the lives of our kids while going after some office or going after some job or going after some position. Men have given away real valuable things going after some piece of tinsel. In pursuit of people knowing who you are, making your mark, give away families and give away the potential to impact little boys. I mean, it's there's a catalog of things, and it's absolutely endless at what we might give away in pursuit of something that don't matter that much. I gave the illustration about a little boy had his hand stuck in his mama's priceless vase. She tried soapy water. She tried it all to get his hand out, and she realized she couldn't get his little hand out. She took a mallet and tapped that vase, and it fell to the ground, and when it did, it exposed the hand of that little boy, balled up in a fist. Son, why is your hand like this? Did you have your hand like this the whole time? Mm-hmm. Don't you know if you'd open your hand, mother could have slid your hand out of the jar? Mm-hmm. What do you have in your hand, son? Why didn't you open your hand? What do you have? He opened his hand, a little old shiny penny. See that? And he's holding on to a little shiny penny, and a valuable, priceless vase is laying at his feet. Right? That's what's in me. I hate it, but it is. And I'm going to tell you something. The appetite that I, or that nature that I indulge, I cultivate an appetite for these things. So let me ask you, what kind of appetite is being cultivated in your life? Watch, what you're looking at, what you're indulging in, the kind of friendships you have, you are cultivating these appetites. You are inflaming these passions. We have to be careful. They're there. They're latent. But as we indulge them, as we do not deny them, ungodliness and worldly lust, what happens is they get inflamed and they grow. It's wrong to despise the blessing of the Lord. This is Romans 6, Romans 7. But now watch this. Listen to what I'm saying. Not only is it wrong to despise the blessing of God, guys, and here's our lesson today. It's wrong to scheme for the blessings of God. Amen. Jacob was wrong. You know what he's doing? He's scheming. How many of you know you don't have to steal what God's already said is yours? God had already, listen, Jacob was going to have the blessing. He didn't have to steal it. He didn't have to shuck, jive, connive. He didn't have to do that. He's going to have it. God had already said it. And if we're not careful, guys, you remember what we said about Abraham? We started looking at Abraham and his life and his walk, his career with God, walking with by faith. What do we say? We say that faith is learning how to live without what? Scheming. You don't have to help God with a lie. You don't have to, we don't have to cut corners to get something to work out to our advantage. Is that getting in? Esau was wrong, but Jacob was wrong. Esau despised the blessing, treated it very lightly. Watch this. Maybe Jacob desired it so much he felt like he had to help God out in him getting it. A little lie here. Cheat a little bit here. So long as I end up with what, quote unquote, God wants me to have. Right? And so, hey, I know there's a lot of meat still on the bone here. But I'm telling you, these are the two great lessons here in this passage. When we look at these two boys, these two natures, one despised it, treated it lightly. And I'm praying for you guys. I pray for myself. Guys, so many times I look at the average church. I look at our men in our church, I being one. You can't get men to be interested in spiritual things, it seems like. We're hitting little balls across the golf courses. And in football season, it's a religion. All these things are so important to us. And the most valuable things, we just sort of, well, a bunch of men here, we just sort of piss away. The opportunity to be church men, to be in church, to say to our boys through our presence, this is important. This is what men do. Our boys learn from us that the things of God is something for women and children, maybe. Big, strong dad. Rah, rah, rah. We're going hunting. We're going to the football game. We're going this. We're going that. And church might be something we do when there ain't something better to do. Or me being a Sunday school teacher. Or me working in a position. Or me doing something for the God to say to my boys that this is important. This is the precious stuff. This is how you have eternal impact and influence, right? So You know, one of these days when we get to heaven, we're going to see what's really valuable. And I hope you don't have to get to heaven and find that out. I hope you open your Bible and let the Spirit of God teach us right now. Amen? Amen. What's really important. So, let's pray. Father, I spoke to myself this morning. You spoke to me by your Spirit, God. And I know who I am. I see myself. I see the Esau in me, Lord, the one who takes lightly the things of God. And I see the Isaac, the Jacob in me, the one who would maybe be less than 100% honest about this or that or the other thing to scheme, to help you out. And so, Lord, help me to see that both of these things are wrong. And what you want is for me to, if I'm risen with Christ, I'm to set my affection on things above and not on things of the earth, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God, knowing that I'm dead in Christ and my life is hid with Christ in God. Help me to see that, Lord. And because of that, then I'll be willing to mortify the deeds of the flesh, God. And my affections, my desires, my ambition, my attention might be towards not earthly things, but eternal things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.